I've been reviewing beauty products for more than 10 years, so not a lot of things excite me, but these things did this year, and I'm going to tell you why. And because I am a chemist and a massive nerd, I'm going into the science behind why as well. Maybe some of these will also become your favorites, but if not, hopefully you will still learn something new that you can use when you're finding products for yourself. If you've tried any of these, let me know what you thought in the comments. Let's get into it. The Olay Super Serum is the best new product I've tried in a really long time. I did a sponsored Instagram post on this, but this video isn't sponsored. I'm purely talking about it because it was such a standout product. So for all of my sponsored posts and review posts, my process is I'll look at the claims and the ingredients, and if that all makes sense, then I'll try it on my skin for usually 2 weeks, maybe more, depending on what the product is. This is really important because even if you know everything about cosmetics, you cannot tell just from an ingredients list how well most products work. It's got limited information, the overall formula is really important, so you really need to test it on actual skin. So for a serum that has actives like this, I will start with my skin at its best. I'll be using my standard skincare routine for a few weeks. Then I'll start using the new serum as the only active product. I'll still be using things like cleansers and moisturizers and sunscreens that I'm really familiar with, so I know what they're going to do to my skin, I can see any difference. Then usually over the next few days, there'll be little skin issues popping up. My most common one is closed comedones. These are little flesh-colored bumps that pop up usually around my jaw area there when a pore gets clogged. It's sort of like a pimple, but not quite. It could very well veer into pimple territory, but it's just build up happening in a pore. I'll usually let that go on for a few days, then I'll know, right, this serum just doesn't work for that, so I'll blitz them. Usually the products for that for me are alpha hydroxy acids and a peeling gel. Then I'll just keep using the serum, see if that happens again, go through this process for a bunch of other skin issues, and then by the end of the trial period, I'll have a really good idea of what the product is and isn't good for, which products and ingredients it's good at replacing. Sometimes my skin will just hate a product or it might not do much, and then I'll go back to the brand and tell them, sorry, I can't do a sponsored post on this, I can't endorse this product. And most of the time, even with products that I really like and recommend, there will be little issues popping up. And that's fine because most serums aren't really designed to do everything. But with this serum, this is one of the very few products where I went from my skin in peak condition, dropped all my usual hard-hitting actives, and my skin just sort of stayed the same. So basically, this just replaced all the actives in my normal, super optimized maintenance routine without making any sort of noticeable difference. I think I ended up using this continuously for like 5 weeks because I was just so surprised. I was just waiting for something to happen and nothing did. I was just using this. Then I had to add a retinoid back in because this doesn't have a retinoid and I want those long-term effects that I talked about in my retinoid video. And that threw my skin out of whack and I had to add a whole bunch of other stuff in to deal with that. It was sort of like one of those old ladies swallowed a fly and then eventually she eats a horse kind of situations. But if my skin wasn't such a baby when it came to retinoids, I feel like I could have used this as the only product. In terms of what's in it, it's got a whole bunch of actives, and I was pretty skeptical at first because usually when you have a product with tons of actives, there will be one active that they'll really focus on getting to work really well, and then the other ones will just be sort of sprinkled in for marketing purposes. But this does seem to get several things to go on at the same time. The main innovation here is Olay managed to get niacinamide to stay active at a low pH. And that normally doesn't work very well, but they worked out a way. It is patented. Olay and Procter & Gamble did a lot of that original research on niacinamide for skin. They're kind of like the niacinamide science people. So this makes the niacinamide get into skin a lot more easily. And according to their testing data, this works a lot faster than Olay's other best niacinamide products. And since niacinamide does a little bit of everything in skincare, I think that's why this works so well. Plus, it has lactic acid as its second active. And lactic acid is one of those things that works really well for my clogged pores. On top of that, there's also palmitoyl pentapeptide 4, which is one of the better supported peptides. There's one of my favorite vitamin C derivatives. There's also hyaluronic acid and panthenol. So it is really gentle and non-irritating, and it's also hydrating. I didn't actually need to use a moisturizer most of the time when I tried it, and that was in winter in Australia. The main downside of this is that it does have a moderate level of fragrance, which is actually quite a nice fragrance to me, but I can imagine that some people might be really bothered by it. The other big downside, which is possibly a bigger downside, is that it hasn't launched in Australia. I don't know when or if it'll launch. Maybe it'll launch with slightly less fragrance because Australian products do tend to be lighter in fragrance. So when I went to the US and smelled your products, I finally understood why everyone hates fragrance so much, because it was just like, the average level was just really obnoxious. Olay also have that really annoying mass market brand thing where they have a whole bunch of products with similar names. There's a whole range called Super Serums, but as far as I know, this formula only comes in this like pretty shiny round bottle. This isn't really a new innovation, but it made a really big difference to my life this year, working out how to find eyeliner pencils that stay on oily skin. My eyelids are super oily, so eyeliners always just smudge or start transferring after a few hours, and I didn't really know what exactly I was looking for. I'd look for reviews where people say particular eyeliners were smudge proof, but then they would smudge on my lids, so clearly my eyelids are just a whole level above. So here's what you're looking for. Number one, you want a volatile solvent at the top of the ingredient list. Volatile means that ingredient evaporates really easily, and these are the most common ones you'll see in makeup. The solvent itself isn't the bit that makes it long wear, but it's a sign that there are film-forming polymers in the product that will stick together after those solvents have evaporated off. So the solvent basically leaves, and then the film-forming polymers, they can get together and form a really nice long-lasting film. The second thing you're looking for is snug packaging, and again, this just shows that there are volatile solvents in there, there's enough in there that they're looking for gas-type packaging. So that stops these volatile solvents from escaping and evaporating and making your product dry out and shrivel and turn into like a lump. If you remember the gel eyeliners that came in pots, they were super popular maybe 5-10 years ago. They're a lot less popular now because the same tech has now been put into pencil form. It makes it a lot more practical as a product because then you don't have a separate brush that you need to carry around and it doesn't dry out and you have to wash the brush. And a big part of why they're now in these pencils is because of these packaging innovations. Some brands have been using these for years, but they are way more common now. Basically, for a really good gas-tight seal, you need one hard component that mashes into a softer component with pressure. That's the same principle behind how screw top products work. They just kind of give you a way of mashing like the hard top of the container into the soft seal on the inside of the bottle. So for eyeliners, what you're looking for is a really thick lid that feels like it really jams on. You can kind of hear them creaking on. This is my favorite gel eyeliner pencil. It's from Revlon, and I hate Revlon because they always make these really good eye products and then just randomly discontinue them all the time. And I'm really annoyed, but I keep going back because they are so good. This is a pencil in a barrel that you need to sharpen, and that is generally easier to make gas tight, but these days there are wind-up products that work really well too. This is the Maybelline Master Liner, and this one is cool because the wind-up part is actually inside the lid. So you can see like the crack where the two components join is in there inside the seal. Also see that this packaging just overall has very few lines and gaps on it, and you can see there is this kind of thick seal inside the lid. The Mersey First Gel Eyeliner is also one of my favorites. This is a wind-up product and the winding part is on the outside, but it's got a surprisingly good seal. It's also got like the thick lid that jams on as well. You can feel that the wind-up part is quite stiff, and so yeah, there is a good seal in there. And this hasn't dried out, I've had it for quite a while now, but yeah, super good product. Another thing to look out for, if there are oily ingredients that are high up in the ingredients list, that is going to be riskier, and one of the common ingredients you'll see there is dimethicone. It's not a complete deal breaker, there are products that work really well with dimethicone high on the ingredients list, and dimethicone does make the product apply smoother. But it does increase the chances that it'll smudge if you have oily lids. Basically, it acts like a solvent, it acts like a makeup remover along with your own natural oils, and that dissolves the film and makes it smudge. And speaking of solvents dissolving, next we have the Bioderma Eye Makeup Remover. So I have raved about the Bioderma Micellar Water so many times, it is hands down my favorite no rinse cleanser. Micellar Water has surfactants in it. These are the cleansing ingredients that you'll find in every cleansing product like shampoo, body wash, even dishwashing detergent. But there are a huge range of surfactants available. It's like a really, really big diverse family. And so the innovation with these micellar waters was to find surfactants that clean well, but they aren't irritating if you leave them on your skin. Now, some micellar waters don't do this well, which is why why a lot of people who have tried maybe one or two say you absolutely need to rinse micellar waters, but this one was actually designed for and tested on sensitive skin, so this is really, really gentle, works really well for most people. I found this so useful for evenings when I couldn't handle washing my face at a sink and dealing with all the water. It's also been really useful for washing my face when I'm trying to avoid a particular area, like a few weeks ago I microbladed my brows and I had to kind of like paint around my brows. So yeah, this year I went through another few bottles, but the new product I wanted to talk about is the Biphasic Micellar Eye Makeup Remover. I've always really liked two-phase eye makeup removers. This is where you have like a layer of oily stuff over a layer of water. I found that these just work really well for removing eye makeup. They're really gentle, they don't need a lot of tugging, and yeah, it's just quick and easy. But one of my big annoyances with these is that the two layers usually separate way too quickly. So you shake it and then you have to race to get it onto your cleansing pad before it starts separating. If you get too much oil on it, then it ends up being really greasy and leaving like a greasy layer on your skin. If you get too much of the water layer, then it doesn't take off eye makeup as well. And most of the time you are getting a lot more oil than the water. So then halfway down through the bottle, you've used up all of the oil and you just have tons of water left, and it's pretty annoying. So one exciting thing about this is that it actually shakes up. I timed this once and it took about 10 minutes for it to completely separate. So that's why I've got a second bottle here so that I can show you the two phases as well as the shaken up one. I thought it was just some sort of accident that this happened, but it turns out it is actually intentional and Biogemma have a patent for this. It's called Eco-Biological Biphasic Cosmetic Composition with Delayed Phase Separation. So the way this works is they use just the right amount of polyglycerol 10 laurate, which is a surfactant, and that keeps the two layers mixed together or emulsified for longer than you need to get the product out onto your cotton pad, but it still separates into two layers by the next time you use it. It isn't the biggest issue. It's more like mildly infuriating, and I guess it is a bit of a waste if you have a whole bunch of water left and no oil in a product, but I just thought it was really neat that someone at Biogemma was also mildly infuriated enough to actually solve this issue. The next product is the Naked Sundays SPF 50 Lip Oils. This one is less of like a specific product innovation. As far as I can tell anyway, maybe there is something in here that I'm missing, but the reason it is innovative, I guess, is because this product sort of just ticks off a whole bunch of things I needed in an SPF lip product. I feel like the main thing that made a difference for me is actually just the fact it's in a doe foot applicator. I know I have kind of mixed feelings on this because it is kind of gross, like you are putting it on your lips and then like dunking it back in and it goes back and forth a whole bunch, but it is preserved so it should be fine. It's just like mentally a bit gross, I guess. But anyway, all of that is not an issue because it just makes it so much easier to reapply. It's so much less messy. It's really easy to just get it on your lips. You don't end up with sticky fingers. And that sticky finger issue is such a big issue when I'm at the beach. I just don't want sand all over my stuff. I want to be able to get the lip gloss onto my lips without touching it with my fingers, without risking sand. It also just acts like a regular lip gloss. It smells really good. They've got four different flavors, I think. I've tried watermelon, cherry, coconut. Those are all really nice. There's salted caramel, which I'm a bit more iffy on. It sort of has this like coffee-ish caramel aroma. I'm sure a lot of people like it. To me, it's just weird because it just makes me feel like I have coffee breath without the advantage of having coffee. It also has no menthol, which is nice. I'm not like a menthol hater. I just don't like the feeling of it for myself on my lips. It also looks really nice on your lips. It's really nice and shiny, and it is really hydrating. I have big lips and all my life they've been really prone to getting dehydrated and cracked, so I am really picky with lip balms. Only a few of them will work for me, so looking for an SPF lip balm, it's just been a mission. I guess the main downside is that it does have a bit of a sunscreen taste, but that is kind of unavoidable with an SPF lip product. I do find that having a doe foot makes it a lot easier to aim it away from like your lips, so I've had less of an issue with these. On the topic of lips, I also wanted to shout out some normal lip balms, non-SPF, that I've just found really good this year. The Dermal Therapy lip balm is really inexpensive. It's about $6 at Chemist Warehouse, but it is kind of hard to get overseas. Chemist Warehouse do ship overseas though, if you want to give give this a go. I've also been really enjoying the Propolis Lip Sleeping Mask from COSRX. This is just a really nice product. It just works really well for softening my lips overnight. There's also the Stralis Lip Glaze, which has just been my main lip gloss that I've been using when I'm not using the Naked Sundays ones. Onto some shampoos. I have a super irritation prone scalp. I've had issues all my life, and most shampoos will make my head itchy within 24 hours, and that's one of the main reasons why I wash my hair every day. There are even some shampoos that make my head itchy after only 12 hours. It is so annoying. So it's really rare that I find shampoos that keep my scalp calm for more than maybe a day. I will talk about irritated scalp more in like a later video, the science behind why it happens and what you can do about it. But in the meantime, I just wanted to shout out some shampoos that worked really well for my scalp. If you have any shampoos that work really well for your irritated scalp, please let me know in the comments so I can add them to my testing list. It's always been really annoying to talk about shampoos because the way they work is really complicated. It's the ingredients working together. I talked about it a bit in my shampoo science video. It is more about the overall formula, and so the ratio of different ingredients makes a huge difference, and you can't just tell that from an ingredients list. I've tried maybe 50 new shampoos as part of this quest to work out the holy grail irritated scalp shampoos. The only real patterns I've found are these. Maybe these will help you. Firstly, avoiding MI and MCI, and these are really common preservatives. I'll put their full names here. A lot of people are allergic to them. They are some of the most common allergens in beauty products, and it's annoying because they are in a lot of shampoos. The other big thing that helped me is using shampoos with ingredients that control yeast. You might have heard of Malassezia yeast. This is the thing that overgrows and causes dandruff, but this yeast can also cause irritation even without getting full-on dandruff flakes. One relatively new ingredient that I've been appreciating is pyroctone olamine. This has come in because it's replacing zinc pyrithione, which was the old, super popular anti-dandruff ingredient that got limited in the EU. This isn't quite as powerful, but it is really nice and formless because it's just really bland. Like, you can't tell that it is an anti-dandruff shampoo. Some of my favorite shampoos for this are listed here, but I've also tried shampoos with it that just do the same irritation thing. So it's clearly not like a complete blanket rule. I've also been using the Durkos selenium sulfide shampoos about once a week, but I'm quite sensitive to the smell of sulfur because I was working in a lab with lots of sulfur stuff, and this just brings back terrible memories. So I don't love using it, but this is one of the least sulfur-smelling selenium sulfide shampoos I've used, and the effect does last longer, so I don't exactly have to use it every single wash. On top of that, I have also found some shampoos that don't have specific actives, but they've been really nice for my scalp, so I think it is more of that formulation thing. I'll go into more detail about all the shampoos I've tried in my later video, whenever that gets done. But this is just a really short list of some shampoos that let me go more than 24 hours without washing. Maybe it will benefit some of you in the meantime. Everything is linked in the description. If you want more reviews, you can check out my reviews playlist. If you want more nerdy beauty science, I did a deep dive into retinol recently. Honestly, my entire channel is nerdy beauty science, so check that out, and if you haven't, like and subscribe.